And welcome, everybody. We are really excited to be hosting this webinar today. As Anne said, my name is Karen Mahon, and I am with Stand.Earth, formerly Forest Ethics. We're an NGO that works on climate and forests, and we stand for the people and places we love. That's what our work in the world is. And in that vein, we're very honored to be hosting this webinar today with my colleagues that you see on the screen. We are discussing the indigenous resistance to tankers and pipelines, which I think we're all inspired by and excited about. In fact, we've had over 1,000 people who RSVP'd to this webinar from across North America. So we're a big group having this conversation today, which is I think, a really great development. Our first panelist will be Ariel Derringer. Ariel is with the Athabasca Chipewyan First Nation, and she is a founder of Indigenous Climate Action. After we hear from Ariel, we'll hear from Clayton Thomas Mueller. Clayton is a member of the Matthias Colom Nation, Matthias Colom Cree Nation. He's joining us from Winnipeg, and he is one of the leaders of 350.org in Canada. And last but certainly not least, we are thrilled to be joined by Chief Bob Chamberlain, who is the Vice President of the Union of BC Indian Chiefs. So thank you all so much, our panelists, for joining us today, taking time out of your busy schedules. We very much appreciate it, and we're really looking forward to hear what you have to say. So I've asked the panelists to speak on whichever aspect of the Indigenous movement against tankers and pipelines they feel most called to, but in particular, how do they see the moment now? How do they see the movement now? And how can people engage and support? So we'll turn over to Ariel to start.
Welcome. Great. Thank you. Thank you, Karen, and merci trop for having me here today. Éclairez-vous, ta Ariel Tsekwe Duranger Houché. My name is Ariel Tsekwe Duranger, and I'm a member of the Athabasca Chipewyan First Nation. And I'm really happy to be a part of this call today because I think when we talk about resistance to tankers and pipelines, we have to start talking about the source. And the fact that there is resistance, indigenous resistance to the expansion of Alberta's tar sands, the very oinl that would be pumped through the proposed Kinder Morgan pipeline and into tankers off the coast of British Columbia. And we can't disconnect the two, and we have to really coalesce our movements together, not just as indigenous peoples, but within the environmental movement. And, you know, we've seen through the last 10 years I've been working on this campaign, and it's different for me. You know, as an Indigenous person, this isn't a campaign that I'm picking and choosing to work on, but it is an intrinsic part of my identity. I don't feel as though I have a choice but to do this work because of the impacts that these activities, extractive industries, and the associated infrastructure have on the rights and title and the survival of the rights and title and culture of my people. So over the last 10 years, we've seen a lot of different movements sort of come together and support Indigenous resistance, but not so much as we've seen in the last 5 years. And I think that's largely because we've seen this resurgence of Indigenous peoples within the public and political sphere, not only reclaiming spaces in decision-making processes, but reclaiming spaces in society as decision-makers for our lands and territory. With the introduction of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People in 2007, I think that was one of the spearheading moments for Indigenous peoples to come and reclaim those spaces in society, whether it was in Canada, the United States, you know, Norway, Philippines, or so on and so forth. There has been a global resurgence of Indigenous peoples reclaiming our spaces as sovereign people and reclaiming our right to self-determination. Because when you really look at it, the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples has a foundation of self-determination. Our communities have been given recognition of our right to self-determination. And while Canada was not a signatory or an endorser of UN DRIP until 2012, we were still pushing for that, and I really think that's been a part of it. And I think that we can't ignore that because one of the tenets of UNDRIP is free, prior, and informed consent. And that's what a lot of this is about. Indigenous resistance to tankers and pipelines is about Indigenous peoples putting forward their right to free, prior, and informed consent. But over the course of the last decade, what we've seen is while we challenge and we extinguish one pipeline, as we saw with the Northern Gateway pipeline, a victory completely built on the premise of Indigenous resistance, not completely, but the foundations of the legal challenges of the Northern Gateway pipeline, and the reason why it was denied was because of the infringements on Indigenous people's rights as described in Canadian law, but also international law, including UNDRIP. But what we're seeing is new proposals or the resurgence of old proposals like Kinder Morgan, Keystone XL, which, you know, just last week, Trump revived that pipeline, with Trudeau applauding him along the way. And we can't allow, our prime minister to parrot President Trump's climate and Indigenous rights denialism. We have to move towards a place where we are pushing back on our governments to meet the commitments that they made, not just within the Paris Accord, but to the implementation of UNDRIP. We have to achieve climate stabilization, not just for the global, atmosphere, but for the protection of the rights of Indigenous folks. Our culture, our identities, and who we are wholly is wrapped up and bound together with the protection of the environment and the climate. Indigenous peoples are the first to feel the impacts of climate change because of our direct relationships with the lands. And that is why it is so critical that Indigenous peoples, Indigenous voice, Indigenous rights are at the forefront of the resistance to pipelines, to tanker traffic, and also the expansion of Alberta's tar sands. The oil that flows through these pipelines is being extracted from lands and territories of Indigenous peoples who have been forced into economic hostage situations and putting communities in positions having to choose between protecting their rights and culture and identity or putting food on the table and roofs over their heads. This is unacceptable. We're supposed to be a first world country that recognizes the rights of Indigenous peoples, and yet we are literally selling out those rights for dirty oil that not only destroys the culture and identity of those at ground zero, but poses huge risks to the communities that live along the extraction routes and live within the coast on the coastal lines of tanker routes. These are unacceptable behaviors. We should be moving in the opposite direction that we're currently moving in. And so I just want to say that while the focus is great in British Columbia, that we have to be coast protectors, that we have to stop these pipelines and tankers from ever being approved, we can't lose sight of the fact that there are larger structural issues that need to be targeted as well, like the things that have allowed these projects to even be proposed in the first place. What is allowing corporations and our governments to support these corporations to put forward these projects that not only take us in the wrong direction of addressing climate change, but obstruct, degrade, erode, and abrogate the Indigenous rights of the communities at ground zero and along the infrastructure. So I really hope that we can continue to not only support the Indigenous struggles of those fighting tankers and pipelines, but that we can support the movement to integrate full recognition and implementation of the rights of Indigenous peoples as they're written within the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, written in treaty and written in Canadian Constitution. Because if we can't get to that point, we're going to continue to see more and more projects pop up, whether it's in mine territory's backyard or in the backyard of British Columbians via pipelines and tanker traffic. And Indigenous peoples need the support and the capacity to be able to continue putting forward these struggles, whether it's in the legal systems, whether it's on the streets, or whether it's in a communications campaign that supports the recognition of Indigenous peoples to continue this struggle. Thank you, Masi Cho.
There we go. Thanks, Ariel. That was really helpful in terms of the framing, I think, of the resistance. you know, from obviously there's the front line on the ground issues in the communities all the way through to the global climate impacts, but to really understand it as, you know, our continued fossil fuel exploration as I think you said, selling basically indigenous rights. I think that is a really powerful frame. Thank you so much for putting us up in that conversation. Next, we get to hear from Clayton Thomas Mueller of 350.org. Clayton.
Hey, what's up, everybody? Super, super stoked to be here on today's webinar. I want to give a big shout out to Stand, you know, Coast Protectors, For the Coast, everybody out there in BC, you know, who's doing the critical work necessary to protect the watersheds, you know, the thousands and thousands of rivers, tributaries, and streams that support the sacred salmon runs of so many Indigenous nations in those beautiful territories. Thank you so much for the work that you're doing. I also wanted to acknowledge the passing of Master Carver Bo Dick. You know, I met Bo when he came to the capital city of Canada, you know, these lands they call Canada, you know, with Gujwa from Haida Gwaii, when they did the copper shield shaming ceremony. That, you know, I really believe it was one of the main things that knocked Harper off of his throne. And so I just want to acknowledge Bo's family and all those people that believed in Bo's work and everybody touched by his expressions as a master carver in a good way. As mentioned by Karen, I work for 350.org. We're a global climate organization. You know, and our job is to usher in the zero carbon economy, you know, for Mother Earth, through ending the era of big oil. You know, there's a common quote that I hear, we didn't leave the Stone Age as members of the five-fingered nation, you know, as humanity, for lack of stones. And the same thing can be said about the fossil fuel era. You know, interestingly enough, you know, this webinar is happening during the year that the settler colonial state of Canada is celebrating its 150th year of confederation, of colonization. And many, many Indigenous peoples from coast to coast to coast are organizing and responding to 150 years of what they say, of what we say, you know, is occupation, you know, of our traditional territories. You know, I think the late Art Manuel, another great movement leader who just recently passed there in BC, said it best. He said, you know, we got to stop asking the guys who stole our land for permission. You know, and I think that that's definitely true. Here in Canada, I think post Harper, you know, with the election of the majority Liberal government federally, you know, I think there was a huge sigh of relief. A lot of people felt that the Liberals would show up in big ways. There was a lot of rhetoric on the campaign trail, including in British Columbia. You know, Justin Trudeau said that he would hold accountable, you know, the flawed NEB process. He would, you know, he would show leadership on the Kinder Morgan issue. And, you know, a year later, there he was approving the Kinder Morgan pipeline against the wishes of, you know, Mayor of Toronto, of Burnaby, other mayors along the route of way, right away, against a multiplicity of First Nations being led by the Tsleil-Waututh Nation. You know, the list goes on and on. And we see, you know, that economically, on paper, that Trudeau is quite simply a handsome Harper. That, you know, he still prescribes to the same neoliberal free market theories of economy. And we still have one hell of a fight on our hands here in Canada in terms of, you know, us collectively pressuring this government to, you know, pass a sane and just climate policy, because the current, you know, conversation around the Canadian Climate Action Plan is lacking significantly. And the contradictions of our Prime Minister, you know, in terms of the commitment he made at the Paris Climate Summit to a 1.5 degree target, well, domestic policy decisions around pipelines are certainly taking us far, far, far away from ever being able to achieve our international Paris climate targets. And secondarily, you know, our Prime Minister was elected with record numbers of First Nations people showing up to the ballot box on election day because of the promises that he had made around the murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls inquiry, around, you know, the ratification, adoption, full implementation of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. But, you know, his own justice minister there in Vancouver, Jody Wilson-Raybould, the first First Nations justice minister, called the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples a political distraction and unworkable under Canadian law. And when him and Minister Bennett at the United Nations announced Canada's support and ratification of UNDRIP, they also ended their wonderful speech by saying that they would do that in accordance with Canada's interpretation and domestic Indigenous policies. In other words, they ain't going to do nothing. What does this mean in terms of Indigenous people stopping pipelines and stopping the expansion of the controversial Alberta tar sands that these pipelines are connected to? What does it mean for Indigenous people stopping tanker traffic in our, you know, ecologically sensitive and just ever so sacred coastal waters there in British Columbia? Well, you know, I think one of the things that Harper wasn't able to do during his 10 years of power without opening up constitutional debate was to gut the legal regime of Indigenous peoples in this country. I mean, he did one heck of a job gutting the Navigable Waters Act and Canada's environmental protections policies, you know, 40 years of environmental and social policy gutted by the omnibus bill agenda of former Prime Minister Harper. And, you know, Trudeau has not rescinded much of that. You know, Trudeau continues to benefit from the powers that have been concentrated in the office of the PMO. You know, he continues to contradict himself, to, you know, continue to, you know, act as though he's campaigning to the left and then governing to the right in typical Liberal fashion. But one thing that we know is that they can't come into our homes and, you know, dictate what's going to happen in terms of our water and our natural resources, especially in British Columbia. You know, the legal regime that Indigenous peoples have here in this country, you know, reinforced by Section 35 of the Canadian Constitution, by over 200 Supreme Court victories, you know, affirming our rights and title to our traditional and treaty territories, these are very powerful legal instruments. The Canadian government, the Crown, has a fiduciary and legal obligation and a sacred trust relationship to adhere to uphold. And that's one of the reasons why we're still, you know, so very, I wouldn't say respected by the Canadian government, but certainly feared. And I think that, you know, one thing that we have to be aware of is that this government will stop at nothing to get tar sands to tide water. You know, and they'll go, I mean, they were even talking about building a pipe or doing a pipeline assessment to Tuktoyaktuk, for crying out loud, at the end of the Harper era. You know, and what we've seen, you know, right from the beginning of the escalation of the Indigenous-led international campaign to stop the expansion of the tar sands, was that Indigenous peoples have the legal regime to hold Canada to account. And when Canada ignores its own laws, we can take them to the courts. But taking them to the courts is not the winning strategy. You know, legal litigations, as we've seen historically, are very costly. They take a long time. So we need to fundraise for that. I encourage everybody watching to support, you know, the legal challenges that are being brought against Kinda Morgan in British Columbia, but also other legal challenges that are happening in the province of Alberta, like the Beaver Lake case against tar sands expansion into their traditional territory, and cases that are being led by the previous speaker, Ariel Deranger's First Nation, Athabasca Chipewyan First Nation. They have a lawsuit against TransCanada, who, you know, has built the Grand Rapids pipeline, which is the mother pipeline to KM and KXL. You know, we need to be supporting these legal challenges, but at the same time, as we learned from the tar sands campaign, we need to be very sophisticated in our social movement strategies. Our strategies need to be multi-pronged, and that includes base building. That means knocking on doors, having webinars like the one that you're watching today, sitting down at the kitchen table with your family, with your cousins, your grandmother, your grandfather, and talking about what you can do to contribute to stopping Kinder Morgan from being built. Out here in our home territory, you know, we've got a big fight against Line 3, the Enbridge pipeline that Trudeau approved in the same speech as Justin. In the same speech where Justin Trudeau approved the Kinder Morgan pipeline, and we've got KXL back on the table. You know, Donald Trump is proven in his first 100 days to be a formidable foe, and you know it's really important now more than ever that sophisticated multi-pronged social movement strategy that we need to be applying in our territories where we live. You know, they need to be grounded in radical anti-racism, radical anti-oppression, and certainly anti-colonialism. And we need to be integrating solidarity into our movements. I think that Standing Rock taught us a lot of lessons. You know, Standing Rock brought together Black Lives Matters with Water Protectors, brought together you know, our friends from the LGBTQ movement. It brought together people from No One Is Illegal. You know, big shout out to No One Is Illegal and the incredible work that they're doing. You know, it's through solidarity and through convergence of our social movements that we will be able to hold to account the mechanisms within the settler colonial state of Canada that even allow for crazy proposals like the tar sands tech mine and like Kinder Morgan to even be on the table. You know, we need to continue to build power in a good way because there's a confrontation that's coming in BC. The Trudeau government is, you know, when they approved Kinder Morgan, you know, that approval meant that they are willing to accept at the scale of Standing Rock conflict. And so, you know, I suspect that conflict is going to come probably during the election year. You know, in the next year, there isn't many scenarios to hold decision makers to account, to put them in a decision dilemma now that they've gone ahead and approved. So we've got a lot of work to do, base building. You know, we need to be expanding our political base of resistance in the Lower Mainland. Certainly, you know, that includes supporting Indigenous-led litigations and organizing efforts, direct action strategies, and that's really what we're doing at 350.org is supporting our friends at the Tsleil-Waututh, you know, and other nations there in the territory, the Musqueam, the Squamish, that are concerned about the tanker traffic and the impact of an oil tanker spill on their food system, which is the ocean. You know, so we're supporting them, but at the same time, you know, supporting narratives that lift up the importance of stopping this at the source. You know, we've been playing a game of whack-a-mole with pipelines for the better part of a decade now. We've done a good job as social movements keeping tar sands oil landlocked, which is no small feat, and we all should pat ourselves on the back. But this fight is starting to escalate now, especially with number 45 in the lower 48 states below us doing all the things that he's doing. We need to stand united, and we need to, you know, understand that that our government's ready for a big conflict, and a whole lot of us are probably going to have to get arrested. You know, so civil disobedience, nonviolent direct action has also got to be another prong in that sophisticated multi-pronged social movement strategy to keep tar sands in the ground and to stop these pipelines from being built. I encourage you to check out, follow us on Twitter, 350 of Canada. We just launched a wicked campaign today against the Canadian Association of Petroleum Producers, you know, which was the main lobby group of big oil here in Canada. They're the ones who gutted the Navigable Waters Act. Greenpeace exposed that. Well, they're one of the biggest sponsors of the iconic Canadian Museum of History. So check out 350 Canada on Twitter. Check us out on Facebook. Please share the cool little video we put out today, encouraging our friends at the Museum of Civilization to drop CAP as a museum sponsor. You know, it's a real sleazy relationship that they don't need to have. You know, they're a really good institution. And a lot of the, you know, they boast the biggest totem pole collection, indoor totem pole collection in the world. So I wanted to encourage everybody in BC, especially my First Nations relatives there, to, you know, support the campaign and to tell the museum to drop cap. And certainly we'll see you in the streets and out on the land in this fight to stop the construction of Kinder Morgan and to reverse Prime Minister Trudeau's support of Kinder Morgan's Trans Mountain project. And I encourage you to support other pipeline fights and certainly the good fight in the Alberta tar sands to keep that project from expanding any further. You know, shut down Teck Mining, shut down TransCanada, shut down Enbridge, shut down Kinder Morgan. Let's do this.
Thanks, Clay. Let's do it. I think we all agree. And I think that was really a great kind of naming of the moment, because we're living some kind of a strange moment, because we've had three pipelines approved in the last 4 months, right? We've had KXL approved just most recently, and as we've said, Kinder Morgan and Line 3 were both approved by our seemingly friendly Canadian government, you know, who talks the talk but clearly does not walk the walk when it comes to these projects. So whether you're south of the border and your heart is probably hurting a little from yesterday, it was a particularly bad day, but know that, you know, that this resistance, in some ways it doesn't really matter who's government, because the resistance is strong and growing, and these approvals are going to make it grow stronger. And this is, you know, all having this conversation together is a big piece of that.
Well, certainly, as we learned with Northern Gateway, an approval does not mean it's going to get built. And I think that that's an important point for all of us to hold close to our hearts as we move forward.
Definitely. It's really the beginning of the next phase. So before we open to questions, and I encourage you to take in notes if questions are coming up for you, I'm going to turn it over to Chief Bob Chamberlain. Are you settled and ready to go there, Bob?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can. Thank you so much.
Okay, I just accidentally unplugged something, but I'm glad you can still hear me. Gaelic Kesla to everybody that's on this webinar. I truly appreciate everybody's interest to be here today. The challenge that we face in protecting our environment and affecting change with the Canadian government and the provincial government here in BC's focus on extractive industries, in particular the oil and gas, is going to take many hands to lift this up. There's no question that this government has lost its way of its commitments to First Nations people, the commitments that it's made to Canadians as, you know, heading into the election and coming out of the election. But I guess the question for us is, what is it that we're going to do and how is it we're going to accomplish that? You know, we had the commitments about revamping the environmental assessment process and so on before anything major gets approved. And as previous speakers have spoken about, you know, all of these have occurred now. All the while consultation with Canadians and First Nations continues. When I consider the federal government and what it is actually accomplishing to date, I think of the most recent announcement of the six ministers that have come forward to have a review of all legislation, regulation, policy, and so on that affects Aboriginal people's title and rights. And knowing full well that the government has embraced the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, as well as embracing all the calls to action from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and also considering the Supreme Court of Canada direction to the government over the decades towards First Nations people and Aboriginal title and rights, the path of reconciliation between the Crown's supposed title and the underlying Aboriginal title to our lands is the highest court in the land's direction to the government. And of course, if you speak to any First Nation leader across the country, you're going to find that the government continues to take the most minimal approach in addressing and embracing and implementing the highest court of this land's direction to them as the Crown. And of course, all First Nations are very tall on this and become quite learned in all aspects of the law to fight the government. Changes that we have, by and large, by marching to the courts. And when I consider that this new, what I'm calling the super six pack of federal ministers and the work that they're taking on, I think we can be guaranteed that it is going to be a midterm, long-term deliverable And so as they begin that examination, and I realize that there's going to be a signing ceremony sometime in April with the AFN's national chief on this, we have to then, I believe, turn our minds to presenting speed bumps in terms of progress on some of the initiatives that we're here talking about today. The oil and gas industry, specifically Kinder Morgan, and also being mindful that there are a number of First Nations that are supportive of this industry. And certainly there are people that find gainful employment in the oil patch and so on. So we have to be very considerate about our approach here. Because I know that at this point, the federal government is beginning a journey of looking at Aboriginal training and how that's going to be going about, and to look at how do we focus in then at transforming employment opportunities from extractive industries to the renewable energy sector. I know that we have a number of provinces in the prairies that have set very high targets for renewable energy in their province. And I believe that if we were to do the same and put the same pressures here, we can stop developments that we know imperil the territories and the environment that we so dearly and deeply rely upon, but then also chart another course where people can find employment and continue to meet the energy needs of Canada. And when I say Canada about the energy needs, I think of bitumen that's going to meet the needs of another country's energy. And if we were to look at how do we make sure that we sustain Canada's power needs first, I believe that we would have a different priority in terms of government approach to what it is that they're accomplishing today. But then, of course, the question would be, in my mind, how do First Nations and how do Canadian citizens come together to ensure that that view is going to be communicated to the governments that are going to be making these decisions? But back to my comment about the six ministers and this window of opportunity that we have, I consider the Canadian government's approach to reconciliation from a government-to-government level is very abysmal at best. It has not accomplished what First Nations envisioned when the Supreme Court of Canada has given such direction to the Crown. And so my thoughts have really turned a fair bit, not that I'm changing focus from that, government-to-government reconciliation. But when I was at the Kinder Morgan rally here in Vancouver not so long ago, and to see, you know, in excess of 5,000 Canadians coming together, it struck me about how important the work is for societal level reconciliation between Canadians and First Nation people. And I believe now with the rising tension within society, what I see and what I hear now is there is no social license for the government to move forward on Kinder Morgan specifically. But I think that, you know, waters the seeds of reconciliation for those of us that are of the same mind and the same level of commitment to protect the environment or Mother Earth or however we view that, and to know that the laws of Canada have provided a very unique place for First Nations in clear opposition to the government's decision today. And as the government moves down the road now of implementing the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People and the Truth and Reconciliation Commission calls to action, we can begin to envision a world where there is going to be some fundamental and systemic changes to how the government is actually operating. And I believe that the work that we could do today is find all those the smaller end of the scale of incremental steps of implementation of the UN Declaration. And by accomplishing that, and that's certainly some of the approaches that I'm bringing into the work that I'm pursuing, is we can then show Canadians that there's not a great big world change that's going to come that they should fear. And so that they could then begin to enhance that, to enhance societal reconciliation between Canadians and First Nations. And part and parcel to that development would be for everybody to communicate to their MLAs and to their MPs and make use of social media and any means possible to communicate your displeasure or your priority of safeguarding environment rather than meeting the needs across the Pacific Ocean with their energy demands, and to make sure that other people are not going to benefit while we as Canadians absorb the environmental impacts, which are certainly the long-term impacts that are going to be realized. And when I think of First Nations people, we draw our identity by and large from the traditional territories we come from. You know, our stories of origin are no different or less significant than any other race of people in the world. And so that love of our territory and the identity that flows from it is critical for our well-being. Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People as well. As we go forward, you know, I mentioned about communicating with our MLAs and communicating with our members of Parliament and, you know, Prime Minister Trudeau and the various ministers that are involved here. We have to turn, of course, to our circles of influence. And each of us have family, we have friends circles, we have organizations that have memberships, we have believers in the environment that are parts of trade unions and so on. And we need to really instigate that level of conversation amongst ourselves, and to ensure that we have a organize a clear message about, you know, the priority of the well-being of the environment, and calling to task the various federal departments that have constitutionally or government mandated protection as the main focus of what they do. When I think of the Department of Fisheries and Oceans, and as was mentioned earlier about the omnibus bills of Stephen Harper's government, the government refined them, and they are currently engaged in that process with First Nations and Canadians alike. And how is it that we're going to put a marker in the development of these extractive resource projects, and to ensure that there is a place for the Refined Fisheries Act or the Wild Salmon Policy or the Environmental Assessment or what have you? So I think that that has to begin to be part of the dialogue and communication from ourselves, is to point out that these things that are coming down the road of legislation and so forth from the government are going to have to be applied to things that are underway today. And I look forward to when we're all going to be out standing together in opposition, so that we can make sure that the federal government and the provincial government, the social license that's in place or not in place as it is, as I understand it today. And so we can begin to ensure that the views of all Canadians are heard, not just the ones that have found their checkbooks, that have significantly larger checkbooks than most of us do, and support these governments. Now, I focus quite a bit on the pipeline itself, but as was discussed earlier, when we start to think about the expansion of marine traffic and all that that means, you know, we've got after the fact protection for the orcas of the South Vancouver Island area, but it's only because of political pressure that has brought that about. Certainly it wasn't a consideration prior, or else they would have announced it at the beginning. But the threats that we have to wild salmon are something that I believe First Nations here, and some of the work I've been doing, is organizing a very strong political voice for the safeguarding of wild salmon. And it is such an integral component, whether it's coastal or wherever, it's way up into the Fraser, the Nass, or the Skeena, and all the other rivers in between. But so we need to ensure that the broad consideration of the impacts that we see and we know will occur are understood by government. So I think that I've taken up a few more minutes than I thought I was going to, but I'll turn it back over to our organizer, Anne. Thank you. Or I could tell a joke.
No, here we come. thanks, Chief Chamberlain. That was great. Dan, thank you, Anne, for bringing in the salmon, an important element that we don't always get to remember. You know, I think this your call around how do people on the call today with us really think about societal reconciliation? What does that really mean? Not, you know, safeguarding the environment is critical, but the societal recognition is, you know, the root behind it all, and how do we actually get to that healing place. I think that's really important. So thank you so much for your comments to all of our panelists. We have lots of questions pouring in. I'll just remind people that on the right-hand side in your little control box, there's something that says questions, and you can just type a question in there, and it will magically come to us. And I'm going to pull some of the questions and share them with our panelists. So the first question we've got is one about starting at the source. So, you know, the pipelines, oil tankers, oil trains, these are all ways that we get bitumen from the source in the Alberta tar sands to various markets. And the issues at the source are very, very critical. So the first question is, how do the tar sands affect you? What does it mean to be impacted by the tar sands? And maybe I'll ask Ariel to start and then others to jump in.
Yeah, I think that being from a downstream community from the development is, the impacts are obviously going to be different than sort of a southern urban Albertan for sure. But I think that there are some clear and undeniable impacts that have been seen from the development of Alberta's tar sands in the degradations to the ecosystems that have been critical for cultural survival of the, you know, our neighboring Cree from the Mikisew and the Dene people in the region, as well as the Métis. And all of our lives, our livelihoods, our culture is it really sort of, it hinges on the intact ecosystems and water systems. And the community of Fort Chipewyan, which houses the Cree, the Dene, and the Métis, is downstream. And it's in a fly-in only community that relies on the Athabasca River as a critical waterway for transportation, a critical waterway to access hunting, fishing, and trapping grounds, as well as harvesting for medicines and berries. And it is a critical water source for drinking water for our community. And what we've seen as far as direct impacts from the expansion and development of Alberta's tar sands is a degradation to that critical water system, a degradation not only in just the flow and rate of flow of the river system, but contamination of the river system from both direct sort of, they sort of put cleaned effluent water into the river system or wastewater, as well as contamination for particulate matter. Now, David Schindler and Dr. Rooney from the U of A have done tremendous studies that look at how the sediment from the particulate matter, the VOCs, lands in the snow, and every spring with the spring melt and the spring runoff that goes into the river systems, it's almost the equivalent of like an oil spill into our water systems every year. Remember, this is a critical water system that's necessary for so many facets of the lives and livelihoods of the people in Fort Chipewyan and even further north in the Northwest Territories in Fort Smith and all along the Athabasca River system. And those are some of the, and that has led, this contamination to the river system, of course, contaminates all those other things. The wildlife, the berries, the medicines, the fish, the waterfowl. So we are seeing not only a degradation to the water system, but a degradation and a contamination of the critical food sources that the community has relied on since time immemorial. You know, 25 years ago, or closer to 30 now, the community was 80% subsistence. 80% of our food sources were from the ecosystems around us, and we're right up against the UNESCO World Heritage Site of the Wood Buffalo National Park, recognized for its tremendous flora and fauna and critical ecosystems for climate stabilization. And we're now at a point where we're looking at this degradation to all of that, and the access to our food sources is slowly disappearing because either through contamination or disappearance of those species. And we're now being forced to rely on grocery stores. And there's only one in Fort Chipewyan where a gallon of milk costs $16 to $18 depending on the season. A loaf of bread, it runs between $7 and $9. And we're not talking like high-end, organic, gluten-free, you know, bougie bread. This is like Wonder Bread. And produce is a real problem. And so we now have like increases of obesity, autoimmune diseases, respiratory diseases, all sorts of ailments that are associated with poor health, poor air quality, poor water quality, and poor quality of life that has been directly impacted from this industry. And of course, on a sociological spectrum, there's this push and fear of continuing to practice some of those land-based cultures that are so intrinsic to our identity, as well as there is now like this and moving away from like traditional food sources, but there's also this fear that we don't have a choice, that we're being forced into these situations, and that, you know, oil and gas is going to develop with or without us, putting us into these economic hostage situations. The impacts affect every facet, from the economic to the sociological to the direct health of communities, where we see lower life expectancies, higher rates of cancers, autoimmune diseases, and it's just tremendous across the entire board. That is the real impacts that we see from tar sands. And so far, you know, we've been pretty lucky because the tar sands are actually not right up against our communities like we see in Fort McKay First Nation. So far, most of the projects exist about, you know, 100 kilometers from our community. But Tech Resources, which Clay mentioned, Tech Resources is the largest ever proposed open pit mine, and it'll be 16 kilometers from the boundary of Poplar Point Settlement, which is one of the settlements of ACFN. 16 kilometers from the boundary, largest ever proposed tar sands mine. I just don't even understand how the Trudeau government or how the Alberta government has even allowed this project to be considered, and how the Alberta Energy Regulator has given it a sufficiency review as to being passing all the sufficiencies that are required for a project. The fact of the matter is we talk a good talk in this country about environmental protection and Indigenous rights respect and reform and in review of all these projects, but we're still seeing Kinder Morgan and Tech Resources being proposed simultaneously at a time when they should not even be considerations on the table. And the impacts that these projects have on the long-term health and longevity of Indigenous communities is so tremendous and hits every facet of their lives.
Yeah, I just wanted to respond to just a couple of points in terms of how does the tar sands impact us. For me, it's the psychology of our young people. You know, Suncor, Petro-Canada, the biggest energy company in our country, is one of the biggest investors in our National Aboriginal Achievement Foundation, INDESPIRE. You know, the National Aboriginal Achievement Awards were just last Friday. One of our most iconic leaders, Senator Murray Sinclair, the chair of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, received a Lifetime Achievement Award under the banner of companies like TransCanada, like Tech Resources, who paid for the award show. And Senator Sinclair got to speak to, you know, youth at the National Suncor Youth Conference at INDESPIRE about the work with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And so, you know, the issue of corporate sponsorship and the way that banks who are financing the tar sands and oil companies that are operating in the tar sands are pervasively infiltrating our cultural, academic, and educational institutions with money, dirty oil money, and having their logos all over everything, including, you know, spaces where our young people are talking about the suicide crisis in this country that's happening in our communities. One has to ask the question about the ethics of that. You know, these companies are the reason why our people are getting displaced from our lands. They're the reason why our people are overrepresented in the downtown east side in Vancouver, you know, because of the radical footprint of these corporations in our lands and the impact on our food security, our water security. You know, they're the reason why people are becoming urbanized, and over 50% of our people live in urban centers like Vancouver, Winnipeg, where I'm, you know, tuning in from right now, Edmonton, where Ariel's tuning in from. There's a reason why so many Native people are in the city and not living in the most beautiful places on earth where Creator put us. It's because of the ecological footprint of these companies working in collusion with provincial, federal government on these extraction schemes. So, you know, the tar sands has a huge, huge role to play in that. And I mean, even in Vancouver, you know, the youth center, the Indigenous youth center that they've been trying to build there for years, just got land donated to them, I think from Syncrude, You know, another major tar sands operator, and it was formerly a gas station. I sure hope that they removed, you know, at least 20 feet down the soil from that piece of land, because who knows how long those gas tanks were leaking there in the neighborhood. But, you know, the point is that these companies are everywhere in our indigenous people's lives. They access and they try to weave an inevitability narrative that they are necessary, that they're a necessary evil, and that they're good neighbors, ethical neighbors, and they throw these modern day bags of beads at our communities through corporate sponsorship schemes, and you know, it has devastating consequences on our young people.
Well, we call it bobbits and trinkets in our community, because they come in literally with iPads and iPhones and all sorts of things still to this day. I mean, there are Suncor and Shell sponsored feasts and community activities in our community that are like, come and enter into a draw for an iPad. And it's very pervasive, and it's a part of this tactic to erase Indigenous identity and assimilate us into mainstream society.
Thank you guys for really bringing the reality to us of what it's like to live, right next to these companies and right next to these companies on the ground. I mean, having been in some of the territories, it's pretty heartbreaking, the basic human rights violations that are happening every day. In those communities, and as Clay says, the sort of colonization of the mind as well, right? I think, you know, the latest is that, you know, they're gonna green up the oil companies. The technology is gonna have lower emissions per barrel, and therefore we should all applaud. It's just the latest. So lots of questions. Lots of questions specifically on pipelines and on Kinder Morgan. An issue near and dear to my heart as someone that lives in Vancouver. Really, your thoughts on the question is, what do you think the best way is to stop the Kinder Morgan pipeline? Who wants to take that?
I'll jump in. Well, as I mentioned in my opening remarks about looking towards the societal uprising and the societal messaging through every possible opportunity that we have, I mean, I know that I believe in the courts yesterday that Burnaby suffered a setback in the courts about their opposition to Kinder Morgan. I believe now, when I think back to the 5,000 people that showed up for the rally that marched through Vancouver across the bridge, I believe that we need to be able to organize more. And so it's not, but not just solely in Vancouver, and to be able to ramp it up in such a way that I know that we came across the bridge and there was a set period of time, but I believe that there's going to have to be a ramping up, a stepping up, an enhancing of what that effort is going to look like. And whether it's, you know, a number of bridges all at one time, or a number of bridges or highways in a number of different locations of British Columbia. And I think that that's where the networking that's occurring through webinars such as this, and all the other good work that's being accomplished here about concerns of the environment. This extractive industry stuff, I mean, it's just not going to go away unless we make sure that it does. And it's going to take every person that has a care and a belief and understanding about the global warming impacts that are happening. Right, you know, the erratic weather that's been going on, and it's a reality that we cannot deny any longer. And we have to start being a little bit more responsible for the world in its entirety, and not simply looking at our little path that we're walking down today, but to realize that our children and our grandchildren are going to bear the biggest brunt of our inaction today. And so I would encourage everybody to do that, to make sure that we bring all of our family and our friends, start getting out there and making sure the government is clear that the rally that we had in Vancouver against Kinder Morgan isn't a one-off thing, and that we look to be a little bit more organized and strategic to make sure the government knows that there's enough people to shut things down, and so that they can begin to understand the severity of the decisions they've made, and let's make sure that they understand that they don't enjoy the social license. Thank you.
Mayor Ariel, would you like to jump in?
Yeah, I mean, I was just going to say, you know, absolutely, we have to be sort of taking taking a multi-pronged approach to stopping these projects, because it's not just about, you know, getting out in the streets and protesting these, but protesting the processes in which these projects have been brought to the forefront. But we also have to think about the fact that these projects wouldn't even exist if tar sands development didn't exist, and if there wasn't a push to continue to expand Alberta's tar sands. Now, you know, Alberta has come out really sort of promoting themselves as one of the best climate policy provinces in Canada, with the only country and the only province with a cap on emissions in Alberta's oil sands. But that cap, when you look at it, allows for a 30% growth in the industry. So that 30% growth also needs a transportation route. And so if we really want to be critical about this and how we're going to stop these projects, because if we don't stop the continued expansion of Alberta's tar sands, if we stop Kinder Morgan, you know, KXL, Line 9, Line 3, you know, all the other proposed routes are just going to continue to have more efforts on them to be accepted and approved. We have to stop the... We effectively have to stop the expansion of Alberta's tar sands. And that is a huge, huge challenge, because we have an entire economic structure in the province of Alberta that has been reliant on it. Now, Alberta has done a really great job of trying to diversify and move away and support, like, transition economies. But what we really need to be focusing on when we talk about Indigenous resistance is how do we support Indigenous people in this transition? Because a just transition in phasing out of fossil fuels, particularly tar sands, is going to be a huge undertaking because of the indoctrination and the finances that this industry has brought, that Clayton talks about, that we've seen are so pervasive in our communities. And we have to collectively address this as a social justice issue and as a way to pull us away from dirty tar sands development. We can't allow for a 30% growth, because that 30% growth means like approval of tech resources, which my community cannot bear the impacts of that project. We simply cannot. That would literally mean the complete abrogation of our rights, and not only of our rights, but there are critical bison herds and caribou herds that are impacted the ecosystems of this country. This is the lungs of the earth. Like, we have to stop these pipelines, but we can't lose sight of the fact that fighting these pipelines and challenging them through the courts, on the streets, in the regulatory structure, also means challenging the expansion of Alberta's tar sands and their policies that allow them to continue to grow business as usual.
Yeah, I mean, I echo everything that Chief Chamberlain and Ariel have said. We've got one hell of a fight, you know, ahead of us. But that said, Justin Trudeau has picked one hell of a fight, and he's got an even bigger fight ahead of him. You know, as I mentioned earlier, approvals do not mean that construction is going to happen. We've seen that with the Northern Gateway pipeline. We've seen that with the resiliency and just the power of social movements. And I think that we need to be very meaningful about directing, you know, the incredible might of social movements, the climate justice movement, the Indigenous rights movement, the known as illegal migrant rights movement, you know, all these social movements that are coming together, you know, to fight against the rise of fascism that's happening in these times. You know, this might that has risen up, this hate represented by, you know, President Agent Orange, is because we're winning. It's because we've got power. You know, we move billions and billions of dollars of investment from fossil fuel companies in the last couple of years, the global divestment campaign. And we've seen, you know, oil rear its ugly head. The oil companies rear their head. And now we understand how embedded they are in our governments. You know, I mean, Exxon now runs foreign policy for the United States. You know, Rex Tillerson is the Secretary of State. And that demonstrates just how powerful they are, you know. So I think while we're doing the work to stop KM, we need to be, you know, we really need to be looking and prescribing to root cause analysis, you know, and that means stopping tar sands at the source. You know, that means, you know, yes, we need to stop Kinder Morgan, but we need to be standing in solidarity with Ariel's community and other communities that are fighting the tar sands, like the Lubicon Cree, Beaver Lake Cree Nation, and many others. You know, and we need to also understand that Justin Trudeau is expecting or willing to accept a Standing Rock level of conflict in the Lower Mainland. And so, you know, Chief Chamberlain hit it right on the head. We've got to organize, organize, organize. We've got a year to base build, you know, maybe less. You know, they've said that construction will start in September of this year. You know, our relatives in Skokolkmok, big shout out to Skokolkmok, you know, to the Manuel family and all those that are standing against Kinder Morgan there in their territory in the interior. The interior nations are rising up. They're going to be, you know, enacting their own strategies, confronting Kinder Morgan and Christy Clark's government. And, you know, there in Tsleil-Waututh and Musqueam and Squamish territory is a big fight that's coming. And I think that that is where the line needs to be drawn in the sand. You know, I think there's a lot of valuable lessons from Burnaby Mountain. People, you know, sure they got beat up day to day there, but then they went home, had a good shower and, you know, shit and shave and had a good sleep. And then they went, jumped on the bus and went right back to Burnaby Mountain the next freaking morning. And that's what's going to happen with KM. You know, and so we need to get prepared for that. We need to be, you know, donating to those that are organizing, especially, you know, yes, we need to keep donating to the legal challenges, support those First Nations-led legal challenges, but we also need to be creating a war chest for legal fees, legal defense, for warriors, water protectors who are going to be putting their bodies on the line in the lead up to the next federal election. And this is really, this is going to be one hell of a fight.
I just want to throw in one other thing. Like, it's not just about legal challenges, though, either. I mean, it's good to support the legal challenges and the legal defense funds, but the fact of the matter is that we spend so much time and so much resources on shifting the minds of decision makers that we're not spending enough time building the capacity of the grassroots. In this case, Indigenous resistance has proven itself to be a clear and critical component that's necessary not only to fight extractive projects, but it's been recognized internationally as a critical component to addressing climate change. And yet we have very little resources being allocated to developing and building a base of Indigenous peoples to ensure that they understand the regulatory systems, the political structures, and ways to challenge it effectively, utilizing all of the spectrums of tactics that we've discussed on this phone call here. It can't just be environmental organizations leading the charge. If we want to uphold and support UNDRIP and sovereign Indigenous rights, we need to support Indigenous-led campaigning that is built from the grassroots up and supported financially, which we have not seen at all in this country. Indigenous Climate Action, which is a project I'm involved in, is the only Indigenous-led climate justice organization in this entire country. And that is so alarming to me that that is the case. And we have no core funding. And that's just the way it is. And like, it's because this is a new model. This is so new because it's this idea of flipping power dynamics and not just focusing on those already in power, which is really supporting the dynamics of entrenched white supremacy, but flipping it and allowing Indigenous peoples to come back and take back their roles, not only as keepers of the lands and protectors of the water, but of their ability to run sovereign communities and sovereign campaigns and develop sovereign solutions that speak for and uphold their rights.
Well said, thank you. And I would encourage people to make sure that you're on the, that you've signed up on the coastprotectors.ca list. Which is the call to action hosted by Chief Chamberlain and by Grand Chief Stuart Phillip. I believe there'll be regular alerts going out there on Kinder Morgan, including things like how you can be trained to participate in nonviolent civil disobedience, and other informational events will be happening. So make sure that you're tuned into that channel. I would also just say that the Treaty Alliance Against Tar Sands Expansion is calling people to speak to TD Bank, who is going to be financing the Kinder Morgan expansion. Kinder Morgan doesn't have enough funds to build the pipeline yet, and they have hired TD Bank to find them the $4 billion that they're missing. So I know there'll be protests this Thursday at the TD Bank AGM. So there's lots of, wherever you're living, there's lots of different places to plug in. You know, the protests will be on the ground sometime probably by the end of this year or early next. But you don't have to wait for that. There's ways to get involved right now. So thank you for that. We have a couple more really great questions. I think the number of people who are with us today are really, you know, really seeing the link more between the Indigenous rights struggle and these climate-related struggles. And so the question is, what kinds of actions should allies prioritize to show their solidarity with First Nations? What kind of actions should people prioritize? Non-Native.
I'll jump in. Number one, Karen mentioned the Tar Sands Treaty Alliance. This is a new alliance that emerged. It's an agreement, a treaty between nations to stop the expansion of the Alberta Tar Sands and its associated infrastructure, like Kinder Morgan. I think that it's initiatives like that need a lot of support. I know UCBIC plays a big role in the leadership of that particular project, that treaty. I don't know if Chief Chamberlain will ever say it, but UCBIC holds a lot of responsibility, and they need your financial support. You know, if you've got ways you can support them to hire the communications specialists and to hire Native organizers to help, you know, initiatives like the Tar Sands Treaty Alliance to be successful. There's a lot of work on the ground that needs to be done, bringing together all the signatories of the Coastal Salish Sea Alliance, and you know, all of those interior First Nations that are rising up, like Squamaw, together with the Lower Mainland Coastal Protectors. There's a lot of organizing work that needs to be done, and they need funding. To hire those Native organizers to go do that work under the principle of the fact that we speak for ourselves. This is absolutely critical. Definitely plus to what Ariel was saying, organizations, social movement vehicles that are Native-led need to be leading Native rights-based interventions, in social movement, in the social movement landscape. And so you need to, if you've got the means, donate to these critical social movement vehicles, so that they can have the same tools, that our brothers and sisters in the environmental movement have, in the labor movement, so that they can have sophisticated communication strategies, digital campaigns, and all of that good stuff that comes with doing this hard work of protecting our coast.
Great.
I'll jump in on top of Clayton's comments there. I really do believe that it's going to take the pockets of the average citizen to be able to organize our peoples. I think whether it's a Twitter account or a Facebook page, the heavy promotion of individuals to other people to join up and to be aware of what's going on. I think if we have as many people that are on board, I've been really quite blown away with the number of Coast Protectors that have signed up upon the call from the Union. And it really does, it just gives strength to people that are involved, and certainly it motivates us even further at the Union of East Indian Chiefs to continue. But I'm thinking now, if we could really push those numbers up and start to really include as many people as we have, what if we ask many people to find a loonie in their pocket, a loonie drive or a toonie drive? If we have, several, if we manage to mobilize a few hundred thousand people for a couple bucks, we're going to have some money that's going to be able to help the grassroots organizations. And I really do believe it's going to take that level of commitment from everybody that signed up to ensure others are part of this as well. In the messaging, whether it's on Twitter, whether it's on Facebook, I think the message, one thing I've really learned over this past year or so is how heavily government and industry monitor Facebook, monitor Twitter, and they monitor everything we're up to. And so I think that if we understand that and use the hashtags to draw attention to the Coast Protectors and First Nation issues and Aboriginal rights, Supreme Court of Canada and the Constitution, this is how Canadians can begin to voice that direction to the government about reconciliation with something meaningful. And then we can, as the politicians, advance the fundamental changes that we know need to occur at the government level. And by doing so, we could then begin to have and exercise fully without contention the authorities that we have over our title lands. And I bet you my last dollar that if you ask the First Nation about their economic development aspirations, there isn't going to be very many that are going to say, you know what, our community really wants an oil and gas pipeline going right through the middle. Now, I just can't see it. You know, not with, you know, with our attachment to our lands and, you know, the belief and the identity we derive from our territories and the natural resources which are constitutionally protected. And so by changing the construct and the fundamental pieces of government operations, then we can have First Nations defining what it is that we want and what we want to see in our communities. I know for our First Nation, we want to do ecotourism on grizzly bear watching. It's consistent with our values. It's something that's emerging in our territories, and it's not going to be out there shooting the grizzlies. It's not going to be damaging the environment. We're going to use that as a means to limit logging in our territories, which further protects the environment and adds to the carbon base. And they're just and say that they don't fear prosperous First Nations. And I think that's one of the messages we need to get out. So thank you.
I just want to add one more tool and ways people can support Indigenous resistance. One, I just want to sort of highlight the fact that what Chief Chamberlain was talking about with the ecotourism is that this is a key thing, is that Indigenous peoples already have and are in the process of developing solutions to mitigate and adapt to climate change. And we have to support those things that may not look as obvious as like a wind turbine or a solar panel project, but the fact that Indigenous peoples, even in Standing Rock, were holding the line to protect their lands and territory that are critical ecosystems for climate stabilization and ecotourism, which supports an economic growth in Indigenous communities, as well as addressing the protection and preservation of critical ecosystems, is a really big and critical component that we need to address. And I think supporting somewhat non-conventional but Indigenous-led climate strategies needs to come, and we need to understand what those are. So there needs to be a better understanding of how does Indigenous knowledge contribute to the development of climate strategies that aren't as conventional and traditional as we see being prescribed by governments, and how do we support those? And supporting those types of initiatives, whether it's community-based monitoring, conservation, co-management efforts of communities to preserve their traditional lands and territories, we need to be supporting those. But what I really wanted to talk about is that when we talk about civil disobedience and nonviolent direct action, that if you want to support Indigenous communities, put your body on the line, because there are racial inequalities that still exist in this country. We can't deny the fact that Indigenous people represent over 26% of prison populations in this country. We represent something like 47% of homeless people in major urban centers. And we experience police brutality and violence at a much higher rate than non-Indigenous and settler populations. So if you are really serious about supporting these initiatives, when there are calls for action for civil disobedience and nonviolent direct action, put your body on the line, because you're not going to have as severe punishment as an Indigenous person may have. And you know, baby boomers, come on, you guys are like, you've already have your jobs and your careers and your lives set up. You don't need to impress some big manager. Put your body on the line. Like, I challenge those people to put their bodies on the lines, because you have your life established. And it's the young people and Indigenous peoples and young Indigenous peoples that are already wanting to get out there and be on the front lines. But take that role and take that risk for a lot of those folks. But also be humble about it, and don't try and steal the limelight, because we need to support that this is an Indigenous-led resistance. And while we ask for you to be on the front, we ask you to step back when it's time to speak.
Well, well said. Thank you so much. Click.
Drop mic.
I know, it's a little hard to go anywhere after that. Well, we only have about 10 minutes left. I'll put in a plug to follow Ariel there, that, you know, I was on Burnaby Mountain a couple of years ago and was arrested along with many others, and there's something, you know, it's not as scary as you think, and there'll be lots of training available, and there's something really liberating about it, because essentially what you're doing in that moment is you're saying, I don't agree with the social norms. Our society is saying it's okay to do this, and I today am breaking those societal laws that say this is okay, because this is not okay by me. So, you know, there's a chance for people to participate in whatever level of protest that you want, and particularly you've heard the call for financial support too, because it's very real. There's real limitations to what different nations and different Native organizations can do with limited financial resources. So there's some specific answers to that question. I think probably our last question of the day would be on divestment. So there's been a lot of great work done on divestment, and now related to Kinder Morgan, there's this TD issue. There was a TD issue related to Dakota Access Pipeline as well. I think banks play a critical role. So the question is divestment from tar sands and pipelines funding really an effective strategy? Maybe we'll start with you, Clay, because I think that's your gig, but you're yawning.
Sorry, I was stretching. You caught me. divestment is one of the primary tools in our toolkit, as you know, for the movement for climate justice. I think that you know divestment is part of the great transition that we are all responsible to facilitate. We need to be putting, you know, similarly to the campaigns for, you know, the ratification, adoption, implementation of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, we need to be targeting our institutions. You know, we need to target our universities, we need to target our municipalities to ratify the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, to, you know, in every jurisdiction that exists, we need to be doing that. And it's the same thing with divestment. You know, if these institutions, whether it's your you know, the Canadian pension plan or your union's pension or your university, you know, big shout out you know, to Laval University for being the first university to divest from fossil fuels here in Canada. That's a monumental victory for those students, and I think for people all across the planet that are involved in this campaign. Canada is so invested in fossil fuels. Our banks, Royal Bank, Scotiabank, TD, BMO, HSBC, they're not our bank, but they're here, super invested in fossil fuel. And these banks, they have a protection mechanism. When you approach them and you say, hey, why are you financing the DAPL, or why are you financing Trans Mountain, what the hell, I don't want that, I hate that. What the bank will tell you is that, well, you know, we're not actually doing that because these oil companies have an A1 credit rating. We just give them lump sum funding at the beginning of the year. What they spend it on is up to their prerogative. And, you know, I mean, bank divestment campaigns is not a new thing. I mean, we ran a slick campaign, not 350, but you know, Ariel and colleagues, you know, we all supported Ariel during her tenure at Rainforest Action Network when they ran the campaign against Royal Bank. And, you know, Royal Bank had to change their social lending policies as a result, you know, to include, you know, their clients taking their money had to get the prior and informed consent of communities impacted by the investment. And the only problem was is that the funders stopped funding the campaign once the policy was changed, and it's never been tested. So, you know, we need to continue to build and fund these divestment bank strategies. And once we get them to change their policies, we need to keep hammering them so that so that you know, they don't continue to not invest in big oil. You know, that we need to change that. And so the other thing too with the divestment stuff is I think it provides a critical vector for new people to come into the movement, for new people to do things. There's a great video that the comedian Sarah Silverman put out there about how she moved her money from a big U.S. bank to a credit union. And it was super funny, super accessible. And that was the point that she hit on, that not everybody's going to go out and get arrested and do whatever, but there are things you can do as an entry point into the movement, like moving your money into a credit union that doesn't invest in fossil fuels.
I just want to add a little bit onto that. It's like, yeah, you know, money rules this world. I mean, even the entire political platforms of our politicians and parties is contingent on funding, on them getting money to run their campaigns and lobby the Canadian public. And like, Clayton has said, you know, we already have these corporations influencing politicians and decision makers in both Canada and the United States and globally, really. And we need to be like looking as citizens that contribute to these massive financial sectors. How do we put accountability onto these financial institutions? It doesn't just stop at the Canadian border with Canadian banks. It's a global strategy. I mean, the movement towards supporting renewable energies, that was done as in a global economic strategy as well, as how do we get solar panels on parity with oil and gas so we can start to begin that transition. These are real critical conversations that have been had. And as Canadian citizens, you have an ability to enact your desire to ask for accountability from your financial institutions. It's not just the RBC that has implemented these new policies. The IMF, which is the International Financial IFC, the International Financial Corporation, adopted new policies under the sustainability principles in 2011 that stated that they wanted free, prior, and informed consent of Indigenous communities for mining projects. Now, Canada has managed to get away from that by saying tar sands isn't mining, it's oil and gas. Even though they utilize the mining technologies, it's not classified as mining. But there are tools in the toolkit when it comes to finances, and we need to start utilizing it, whether it's within the lending policies of RBC or the international policies by the you know, World Bank and IFC and the IMF. They are already talking about reform because all of those systems are relying on antiquated policies that were created before social justice was something and you know, corporate responsibility was a real thing. They're using policies that were created 150 years ago or more, and we have to push back. And we are a new society that's recognizing the rights of Indigenous peoples, corporate social responsibility, all of these things, and yet we have all these antiquated policies in the financial sector. We all have bank accounts. Let's utilize them, and let's utilize our voice to ensure that there are changes to the financial structures that don't allow and railroad the rights of Indigenous peoples and the environment.
Great.
Well, I want to jump in and absolutely agree with the previous comments. I mean, we have to be able to identify any and all levers we can pull on to make sure that the Canadian government hears our voices, whether it's relocating our savings and checking accounts to places that are not going to be investing in these types of industries, and that's what we need to do. We also, you know, I often say whenever I get a chance to speak at rallies and so on, that this here is probably one of the easiest, simplest tools that we all have to begin and facilitate the social movement we're describing. If we were to take a moment and do a 15-second video, you know, and hash and the things that we know people will pick up on, then we can start to get a little snowball off the top of the mountain so we can continue to grow and encourage more and more people to do the same. And then we can actually reach a further audience than perhaps we think that we could just having conversations. But, you know, I do think, like I say, if there's a lever, we got to yank on it, pull on it, jump on it, hold it down, and make sure that the government sees that we are all doing that and that we're not going to be going away. And if it means we're all lining up to get, you know, blue ink on our fingertips, well, then we're going to have some really great company when we do that. And I'll be bringing my drum, I'll be singing what I can, and I look forward, we can all come together. In our language, it's called Gulgulposhla, and that's when we lock arms and gather strength from each other. And I think that that's what we're pursuing here, and that's the candle we have to turn into the biggest flame possible.
Wonderful. So we've heard, thank you to all of our panelists, this was a great conversation. And, you know, we've heard a lot of specific suggestions here. Use your social media network. That's what Chief Chamberlain just said. We all have a computer in our pockets, and you are the people who can organize. We can help, and you can organize. Move your bank account. Get trained. Think about participating in a protest at whatever level. And donate to the organizations and nations you see here today. Also, we have mentioned pulltogether.ca is a fund that funds legal strategies led by different First Nations. So that's another one to put in your toolkit. And mostly I would say stay informed. Coastprotectors.ca is one of the hotlines hosted by the Union of BC Indian Chiefs. So I would say stay informed. Make sure you're talking to your friends and looking for ways to engage. So thank you all. We have just, I just want to hear, like, what's one sentence? Can you do just one sentence from each of you? One message that you have, only one sentence that you're to our folks as way by way of closing. I'm going to start from my left to right. So Chief Chamberlain, would you start?
With our unity, we're going to find the strength we need.
Beautiful. Okay.
Keep it in the ground.
Keep it in the ground.
You stole mine. Stop it at the source. Implement the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People.
Right on.
Absolutely beautiful. May it be so. And just a reminder to you all that in your RSVP, there'll be a link to this if you want to access the recording. And stay strong. We're getting stronger all the time. We shall prevail. Thank you all for calling in.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Gaelic, I said.